Picture this, waking up to the notification that you just had a $700 payment hit your account. This payment wasn't from a bonus from your job, you didn't have to work overtime for this payment, and in fact, you didn't even have to work for it at all. This was my reality last month, and this reality was made possible by investing into high-quality dividend stocks. And for the last 10 years, I've been focusing on building a portfolio of high-quality dividend stocks that I believe will help me achieve my long-term goal of one day being able to live off dividend payments. Now, unfortunately, I made a lot of mistakes when starting my dividend portfolio over a decade ago, but because of those mistakes and my commitment to continually studying dividend investing, my dividend portfolio now pays me on average over $430 every single month, not to mention I've also seen well over $20,000 in gains over a short period of time. And in this video, I'm going to show you how I'm going to turn my portfolio into a dividend kingdom this year and how you can do the same. We'll discuss things to look for when analyzing dividend stocks and how to avoid some of the same mistakes that I made over a decade ago. So let's go ahead and start discussing how to build our perpetually growing, perpetually cash flowing machine. And like always, if you'd like to join a community of dividend investors and get access to any of my spreadsheets, then you can head over to my Patreon page at the link in the description. So when we talk about building a dividend kingdom, we need to start with the very basics. So for example, if we look at my portfolio, blow up this growth chart, you can see every single one of these positions in my portfolio pays a dividend. And if we jump over to Seeking Alpha, let's go ahead and use the Home Depot company as an example. If we come over here, we can see the yield for Home Depot sitting at 2.41%. Now, what does that mean? Well, on a very basic level, if we invested $100 into Home Depot, that means they would pay us $2.41 every single year in dividend income. But that really doesn't paint the whole picture, because we have to understand quality companies increase the amount they pay out in dividends every single year. So if we jump over to the dividend tab here on Seeking Alpha and look at the dividend history and scroll down, if I zoom out and look at the past 10 years, we can see every single year, this company is increasing the amount they pay out in dividends. And in fact, over the past 10 years, they went from 47 cents every single year, now all the way to $2.09 every single year in dividend payments. And this is where a lot of investors make their very first mistake. And it was a big mistake that I made when I first started dividend investing, and that is focusing too much on the dividend yield. If we jump back over to the summary tab, you probably thought investing $100 to only get $2.41 every single year, that doesn't really seem very exciting. And that is the trap that most dividend investors fall into, because they don't understand the dividend growth component of dividend investing. So for example, let's look at Walgreens. We've had a lot of news around Walgreens over the past week. And right now we can see their yield is showing 3.94%, but their starting dividend yield around a month ago was sitting at 9%. Now that's a pretty high starting dividend yield. That's getting $9 for every $100 that you invest into the company. But if we jump over to the dividend history for this company, I'll scroll down, and this is what we don't want to see. Right here, we can see they had a massive dividend cut. They were paying out around 48 cents per share every single quarter, but they recently had to cut their dividend payment to 25 cents per share. Now, the reason they had to do this was because those large dividend payments were not sustainable for the company. And so if you're someone investing into very high yielding dividend stocks, getting dividend cuts are a huge threat to you, and it can really hurt your ability to build a dividend kingdom. So how can we know whether or not a company is at risk of having a large dividend cut? Because again, that could be devastating to building a dividend portfolio. Well, for example, let's go ahead and go back to Home Depot. And again, we're talking about a company with a low starting dividend yield sitting at 2.41%, but the company has seen massive dividend growth over the past decade. But again, how can we know these dividend payments will continue to grow moving forward? How do we know they're not at risk of receiving a dividend cut? Again, something very devastating to your portfolio. And to answer that question, we actually need to ask ourselves another question. And that question is, where did dividends come from? And that question is the heart of dividend investing. We need to understand that dividends come from free cash flow. So if we jump over to the financial statement for Home Depot and click on the cash flow statement, what we want to do is we want to scroll down all the way to the bottom and look for free cash flow per share. And right here near the very bottom, we can find it. Here we have the free cash flow per share for Home Depot. Now, free cash flow is the cash that a company generates after accounting for all the cash outflows to support the operations of the business. And what we need to understand is there is five different things that a company can do with their free cash flow. They can reinvest back into the business. That's definitely something you want to see every company you're investing doing. They can buy back shares, they can pay down debt, they can attempt mergers and acquisitions, and they can also pay out dividends. So when we look at a company like Home Depot and we see growing free cash flow over the past decade, that's a great sign for the company. If a company is going to be able to continue to grow their dividend payments every single year, then that means it has to be supported by growing their free cash flow every single year. So looking for growing free cash flow is definitely something you want to see, but we can actually dig into this a little bit quicker and make this process a little bit simpler with something called the payout ratio. If we jump back over to the dividend tab here on Seeking Alpha and click on dividend safety, if I scroll down right here, we can see what's known as the cash flow payout ratio. And this number is showing 42.65%. Now, what does that even mean? And like I mentioned just a moment ago, there are five different things that a company can do with free cash flow. And one of those options is payout dividends. So that means dividends are paid out of the free cash flow of a company. So if a company has a cash flow payout ratio sitting at 42.65%, that means 42.65% of the company's free cash flow is being used to pay out dividends. So if we think about it in a different way, that means around 60% of the company's free cash flow can be used to do things like reinvest back into the business, pay down debt, attempt mergers and acquisitions, and buy back shares. So based on the fact we've seen Home Depot is committed to increasing their dividend payouts, they have growing free cash flow and a very healthy cash flow payout ratio, we can assume that they'll do a good job of continuing to increase those dividend payouts over time. So when I'm trying to build my personal dividend kingdom, those are some of the qualities that I'm looking for. Now you still have to be careful because there are some other things that can definitely trip you up as a beginner dividend investor. And I'll show you another one of the mistakes that I made. For example, let's take a moment and look at Verizon Communications. This is another company with a very nice starting dividend yield sitting at 6.81%. If we go over to the dividend history tab for this company, we can see over the past 10 years, it looks like they have consistently been paying growing dividends. In fact, this is a company that's paid out dividends for 23 consecutive years and has actually increased the amount they pay out in dividends for 19 consecutive years. If we jump over to the dividend safety tab and scroll down, we can see the cash flow payout ratio for this company sitting at around 30%. So based off all those things, at first glance, you would think Verizon seems like a pretty great option for building a dividend portfolio. But here's part of the problem. If we click on the dividend growth tab here on Seeking Alpha, one of the things we can do is see the 3, 5, and 10-year dividend growth rate. And like I just mentioned, this company has been increasing the amount they pay out in dividends for 19 consecutive years. We can see the 3-year dividend growth rate sitting at 1.97%, the 5-year at 2%, and the 10-year dividend growth rate sitting at 2.34%. So yes, they're growing their dividends, but here's the huge problem with this. If a company is not growing their dividend payments higher than the rate of inflation, then that company is technically paying out less in dividends every single year. So when you take into account over the past 3 years, the economy has seen very high levels of inflation, Verizon is actually technically paying out less in dividends. Combine this with the fact that if we jump over to the financial statements, look at the statements of cash flow, and again, scroll down all the way to free cash flow per share, it looks like Verizon's really not doing a good job of growing their free cash flow per share, and all of a sudden you may be a little bit more hesitant to consider adding Verizon to your portfolio. Now, what you may be thinking is, yes, maybe Verizon doesn't have the ability to grow those dividend payouts at a high rate like Home Depot was, but it's worth it due to the high starting dividend yield. And if our long-term goal is to be able to live off dividends, then shouldn't we be seeking out to make as much in dividend income as possible as fast as we can? Well, let's go ahead and put that theory to the test. So essentially what we're asking is, should we focus more on high yield dividend stocks or focus more on dividend growth stocks? And this is something I have researched extensively over the past decade. So let's put that question to the test. Let's look at a hypothetical scenario where our cost of living is $4,000 a month right now. Now, considering the fact on average, inflation is typically around 2% a year, our cost of living will increase every single year. So again, if our cost of living right now is around $4,000, in 30 years, assuming 2% inflation, that means our cost of living will sit at $7,245 at the end of our 30-year period. So the goal for our dividend kingdom is to find a way to make our dividend payments on a monthly basis get above this black line and stay above the black line indefinitely. So let's jump over to our portfolio projection tab. And this is a way that I've modeled out future portfolio performance over a 30-year period based on some variables that we can plug in. Let's first say, for example, we're going to contribute $1,000 every single month to our portfolio. We have a starting portfolio size of $0. We'll achieve a price growth rate of around 6%, dividend growth rate of 0%, and a starting dividend yield of 6.5%. So basically what we're doing is we're looking at a scenario where we're investing into a high yield dividend stock. If we jump over to my live off dividends analysis, again, we can see this black line is my cost of living and this red line is my monthly dividend payments on average. At no point with this scenario did my monthly dividend payments surpass my cost of living over a 30-year time period. Keep in mind, in this scenario, I'm reinvesting all the dividends that I make back into my portfolio. And even then, my red line still didn't surpass my cost of living. Now let's look at a second scenario where we invest into a dividend growth stock again. We'll assume we're contributing $1,000 on a monthly basis with a starting portfolio size of $0. But in this scenario, we're investing into a dividend growth stock. So typically we'll see a higher price growth rate. So we'll assume around 7% price growth. We'll assume 9% dividend growth. That's a much higher dividend growth rate, but we're also assuming a much lower dividend yield. This time we're assuming a 3.5% starting dividend yield. So if we jump over to our live off dividends analysis, we can see dramatically different results. In this scenario, our red line does pass the black line, meaning at one point, we will be able to live off dividend income. We can also see that when you invest into dividend growth stocks, the results are exponential. That's because when you invest into dividend growth stocks, there are three different things that cause the snowball effect to truly take place. One, you have consistent contributions to your portfolio. Two, you reinvest all of your dividend payments back into your portfolio. And three, most importantly, you buy stocks that have a good track record of increasing those dividend payouts every single year. When you combine those three factors, you get what's known as the snowball effect, and essentially it means that your portfolio can grow exponentially. So you have to be extremely careful when investing into high-yielding dividend stocks. For example, we saw another high-yielding dividend stock just a little while ago cut their dividend payments. Medical Properties Trust has a massive dividend yield, but if we look at their dividend history, because of those dividend payments weren't sustainable, we saw a massive dividend cut with them going from 29 cents per share to now paying out 15 cents per share. And those dividend cuts will dramatically slow your snowball effect. Now on the flip side, let's look at a dividend growth stock that I've seen huge success from, and that is Broadcom, stock ticker AVGO. If we jump back over to my do-it-yourself investor toolkit and blow up my growth tab, we can see this is a position I've seen over 112% gains from. If we look at my dividend dashboard, we can also see it's a position that currently pays me around $64.26 a year in dividends. But here's the most interesting part. If we blow up my dividend yield on cost chart, we can see over here, my yield on cost for Broadcom stock ticker AVGO is sitting at 4.04%. But if we jump over to Seeking Alpha, we can see the starting dividend yield for this company currently sitting at 1.94% right here. So what's the deal? How was I able to achieve such a high yield on cost for this company? Well, the first is because I was able to buy in at a great value. I think valuation plays a major role in the decision you should make when considering whether or not to add a company to your portfolio. And when I first analyzed Broadcom, I really felt like it was trading at a good value. Combine that with the fact that this company has a great track record of increasing their dividend payouts every single year, and it's allowed me to achieve a very high dividend yield on cost for this company. So again, even though the company's yield is below 2% right now, I'm achieving an over 4% yield on cost. So if we jump over to the company's dividend growth tab, we can see 3-year massive dividend growth over a 5-year time period, massive dividend growth in over a 10-year time period, absolutely unbelievable dividend growth at 36%. So if we jump over to the dividend yield tab, if I scroll down, let's look at yield on cost over a 10-year time period. Basically, this is telling us if we invested into Broadcom 10 years ago, our yield on cost would be 38.54%. So even if we don't reinvest any dividends and we made a one-time $1,000 investment into Broadcom 10 years ago, we'd be making over $385 every single year in dividend income, and that payment would continue to increase every single year. And that reason alone is exactly why dividend growth beats high dividend yield stocks long term. Not only do they pay you more in dividend income, but you can also see massive gains in your portfolio, just like I saw with Broadcom. Now, with all that being said, investing can still be quite scary for some people, unless you are a dividend growth investor, and I'll explain why. If we look at a chart of the S&P 500 index dating from 1872 all the way to 2022, we can see there has been a ton of volatility over the past 150 years in the S&P 500. In fact, even in the past 15 years alone, 2022, we saw the market decline over 20%. 2008, we saw the market decline almost 40%. So again, over a long time period, tons of volatility, and even over a short time period, over the last 10 years, a lot of volatility in the market. But dividend growth investing protects you from this volatility. And here's how. If we jump back over to Seeking Alpha and look at the S&P 500 ETF, SPY, look at the dividend growth over the past 10 years. Again, keep in mind, 2022, we saw a huge decline in the market of over 20%. 2018, we saw a large decline in the market. But despite this, the dividend payments from the S&P 500 increased every single year. So the beauty of dividend growth investing is that even if the market were to decline by around 10% any given year, my dividend payments can still increase 10% or more. And this is exactly what I was talking about on my Twitter/X account just the other day. I find it incredibly motivating that my dividend income can grow rapidly even during a bear market. And just like I said, if the market goes down by 10%, my dividend income can still climb by 10%. And keep in mind, this is even without contributing new capital, my income can grow from reinvesting my dividends, and the holdings in my portfolio can increase their dividend payouts when I buy dividend growth stocks. And this alone can kickstart the compounding effect regardless of what kind of year the market is having. In fact, at times this can even be beneficial because if I'm reinvesting my dividends back into my portfolio when valuations are low, I can buy more shares of companies that I love, in turn paying me even more in dividends. So my plan for the new year and moving forward is actually relatively simple. I have to find phenomenal companies trading at good valuations that have the ability to increase their free cash flow per share year over year, and as a byproduct of that, I'll see massive dividend growth and massive share price appreciation. That's already been the case for many of the holdings in my personal dividend portfolio, and like I mentioned, I'm up over 100% on AVGO, I'm up over 61% on JP Morgan, up over 44% on a stock like Microsoft. And I've also seen massive gains from many of the positions in my portfolio over just the past few months. Over time, this will kickstart the snowball effect, and in fact, I think I would even argue that the snowball effect has already started with my personal portfolio. You can see these are my dividend payments every single month over the past few months, and it's really started to explode over the past year. In fact, last month was my highest month of dividend income ever at $934.25. And you don't have to be a data scientist or data analyst to tell I'm clearly trending in the right direction. So even if I didn't contribute any new capital to my portfolio last month, I had $934 being reinvested right back into my portfolio, which will in turn make me even more in dividends. Keep in mind, I also had many quality companies announce dividend increases in December, meaning they're now going to be paying me more in dividend income. So there's no doubt the plan really is coming all together. My portfolio is turning into a dividend kingdom. Hopefully in this video, I was able to lay out some guidelines that will help you do the same in 2024 and beyond. If you'd like to download any of my spreadsheets that you saw in this video, then you can head over to my Patreon page at the link in the description. You can also follow me over on Twitter for more investing insights and sign up for my weekly newsletter. Link is in the description for both of those things. But with all of that being said, thank you guys so much for watching this video, and please don't forget to like and subscribe to the channel.